गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस एनाफिलैक्टिक शॉक। वी ऑलरेडी हैव डिस्कस्ड डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ शॉक। वी स्टार्टेड विद कंपनसेटरी मैकेनिज्म, देन वी स्टडीड हाइपोवोलेमिक, कार्डियोजेनिक, सेप्टिक शॉक, न्यूरोजेनिक शॉक, एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट एनाफिलैक्टिक शॉक। नाउ दिस इज अ केस सिनेरियो। बाय दिस केस सिनेरियो विल बी एबल टू understand what is anaphylactic shock. So Mona went to a picnic with her friends at a beach. Everyone brought food and shared them for lunch. Moments after biting off a chunk of sandwich, Mona went dizzy and complained of severe shortness of breath. It turned out that this sandwich is a peanut butter and jelly ensemble, and Mona is allergic nuts. So she was immediately rushed to emergency department and was diagnosed with anaphylactic shock. Okay, so this is a situation where peanut butter or peanuts is the source of or is the cause of anaphylactic shock. So if you see the scenario, this is moments after, just after having a bite of a sandwich with peanut butter, Mona was dizzy and there was severe shortness of breath. So that is the anaphylactic shock, which occurs within minutes and seconds. Okay, so that is the issue with anaphylactic shock. So anaphylactic shock is a severe, potentially life-threatening allergic reaction. It can occur within seconds or minutes of exposure to allergens. Allergens are those agents which causes anaphylactic reaction. Okay, can you see this face? This is a case of anaphylactic shock. Okay, so it is severe and it is potentially life threatening. What do you mean by potentially life threatening? Agar aap manage nahi karne se jaan ke liye bhi khatra hai, that is potentially life threatening. Okay, and second thing to be kept in mind is it occurs within seconds or minutes. Okay, now that was definition of anaphylactic shock. Now we are going to study some basics about mast cells, basophils, prostaglandins, etc., because unless and until we know what are these, we will not be able to understand the pathophysiology. So to have a better understanding of the pathophysiology, we are going to study some definitions, some subject matter. Okay, so mast cell, what is a mast cell? It is a type of WBC that is found in connective tissues all throughout the body, especially under the skin, blood vessels, lymph vessels, nerves, lungs, intestines. Okay, so what are mast cells? They are a type of WBC and they are found in all connective tissues throughout the body, and they are specially, they are present under the skin. And because they are specially present under the skin, so this is the first line of defense. So mast cells are the first line of defense because they are present especially under the skin. Now what is the role of mast cells? Mast cells contribute to homeostasis in the immune system. Okay, now what is homeostasis? It is a healthy state that is maintained by constant adjustment of biochemical and physiological pathways. Okay, so that is meaning a normal state of immune system. If the immune system is working normally, so that is due to mast cell. Okay, so mast cell contributes to homeostasis of the immune system. Okay, so two things we have studied. It is a type of WBC. It is present in all types of connective tissues. It is the first line of defense. And fourth is it contributes to homeostasis of the immune system. So homeostasis is the healthy state of the immune system where you have a perfect balance between constant adjusted state of biochemical and physiological pathways. Now mast cell has a central role in the initiation of allergic immune response, that is providing signals inducing IgE synthesis by B lymphocyte. Okay, so this IgE is synthesized by B lymphocyte and signal for it is given by mast cell. Okay, so this occurs in allergic immune response. So whenever you have allergy, there is secretion of IgE, and this secretion of IgE is signaled by mast cell. बात आपको समझ में आ गया? एलर्जी है, जब एलर्जी है तो आई जी ई प्रोड्यूस होता है, तो आई जी ई प्रोडक्शन के लिए मास सेल की तरफ से सिग्नल आना जरूरी है. सो दैट इज़ वाई इट हैज़ अ सेंट्रल रोल इन द इनिशिएशन ऑफ एलर्जिक इम्यून रिस्पॉन्स बाय प्रोवाइडिंग सिग्नल्स इंड्यूसिंग और इंड्यूसिंग मीन स्टार्टिंग आई जी ई सिंथेसिस एंड आई जी इज सिंथेसाइज बाय बी लिम्फोसाइट्स. ओके, नाउ histamines are also released by the mast cells. So when histamines leave the mast cells, they boost blood flow in the area of a body the allergen is affected. This causes inflammation, which lets the other chemicals from immune system to step in and do the repair work. Okay, so mast cell has a role not only to maintain the homeostasis or not only in homeostasis of the immune system. Second is it gives a signal for IgE production from the B lymphocyte. Third is it releases histamine. Histamine is also released by basophils also. Histamine is also released by mast cells. So whenever histamine is released, it causes a boost in the blood flow. Boost मतलब बढ़ जाता है, blood flow बढ़ जाता है. जिस भी एरिया में affected है, there is increase in blood flow. So whenever there is increase in blood flow, the reparative mechanisms can be done in a better manner. Now basophils, ठीक है, mast cells will come. ये भी जितना हमने word पढ़ा, these all words will be coming in pathophysiology. Okay, so basophils, what are they? They are also a type of WBC. They contain granules which are filled with histamines. So basophils mein kya hai? They have a granules which are filled with histamine, and a histamine is related with allergic reaction. So when basophils encounter allergens, and what are allergens? They are antigens they cause, which cause allergic reaction. They release histamine, and histamine causes blood flow to the damaged tissue, and this results in swelling and inflammation. Okay, now basophils mein basically there are two things. They are a type of WBC. Second thing, they cause a release of they cause a relief of histamine. So histamine is released whenever they come in contact with allergens. And what are allergens? They are antigens which causes allergic reaction. So whenever histamine is there, this causes increase in blood flow, which results in swelling and inflammation. Okay, now we have IgE receptor. See, this was IgE synthesis, IgE प्रोड्यूस हो गया. नाउ देर आर आई जी ई रिसेप्टर. आई जी ई रिसेप्टर का नाम है एफ सी ई आर वन, विच इज़ प्रेजेंट इन मास सेल एंड बेसोफिल्स. ठीक है, सो मास सेल और बेसोफिल के ऊपर आई जी ई को फिक्स करने के लिए यू हैव आई जी ई रिसेप्टर. आपको आई थिंक द कंसेप्ट इज क्लियर. मास सेल एंड बेसोफिल्स हैव रिसेप्टर, स्पेशलाइज रिसेप्टर इन देम. ओके, सो this IgE receptor is FcE R1, and this is present in mast cell and basophil. Okay, now there's another word which is called as degranulation. And what is degranulation? It is a release of mediators. Okay, now mast cell degranulation leads to release of preformed mediators including histamines, which binds to a variety of receptors. Okay, so mast cell degranulation ka matlab kya? It release of mediators. And mast cell degranulation mein there is release of mediators, and histamine is one of the it is a preformed mediator, histamine, and histamine binds to a variety of receptors. Now we have another word, de-nevosynthesis. What is de-nevosynthesis? It refers to synthesis of complex molecules from simple molecules such as sugar or amino acids. See, two things are there. If you see this mast cell, दीज आर प्री फॉर्म्ड मीडिएटर्स. प्री फॉर्म मतलब पहले से बना हुआ. सो वेन एवर द मास सेल स्टिमुलेटेड इट कॉजेज द रिलीज ऑफ हिस्टामिन. बट अपार्ट फ्रॉम हिस्टामिन डी निवो सिंथेसिस इज देयर. वॉट इज डी निवो? इट रेफर्स टू सिंथेसिस ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्स मॉलिक्यूल्स फ्रॉम सिंपल थिंग्स. एंड वॉट आर दिस सिंपल थिंग्स? शुगर एंड अमीनो एसिड. सो इट द सिंथेसिस ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्स मॉलिक्यूल्स फ्रॉम सिंपल मॉलिक्यूल्स सच एज शुगर्स एंड अमीनो एसिड्स इज कॉल्ड एज डी निवो सिंथेसिस. ओके, नाउ नेक्स्ट वर्ड इज प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन. नाउ वॉट आर प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन? दे आर हॉर्मोन लाइक सब्सटेंसेस एंड प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन इज डिराइव फ्रॉम एरिकेडोनिक एसिड. सो एंड द प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन दे पार्टिसिपेट इन अ वाइड रेंज ऑफ बॉडी फंक्शंस सच एज कॉन्ट्रैक्शन एंड रिलैक्शन ऑफ स्मूथ मसल, डायलेशन एंड कॉन्स्ट्रिक्शन ऑफ ब्लड ब्लड वेसल, कंट्रोल ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर एंड मॉड्यूलेशन ऑफ इन्फ्लामेशन. सो प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन आर प्लेइंग अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल. दे आर हॉर्मोन लाइक सब्सटेंसेस. दे आर डिराइव फ्रॉम एरिकेडोनिक एसिड एंड दे पार्टिसिपेट इन वेराइटी ऑफ फंक्शंस. फर्स्ट इज कॉन्ट्रैक्शन एंड रिलैक्सेशन ऑफ ब्लड वेसल्स, कॉन्ट्रैक्शन एंड रिलैक्सेशन ऑफ स्मूथ मसल, कंट्रोल ऑफ वेन एवर डायलेशन कॉन्स्ट्रिक्शन ऑफ ब्लड वेसल्स इज देयर नेचुरली इट विल लीड टू कंट्रोल ऑफ ब्लड ब्लड प्रेशर एंड मॉड्यूलेशन ऑफ इन्फ्लामेशन. ओके, नाउ अनदर थिंग विच इज कॉल्ड एज ल्यूकोट्रींस. एंड वॉट आर दे? दे आर प्रोडक्ट्स ऑफ एरिकिडोनिक एसिड मेटाबॉलिज्म एंड आर रिलीज फ्रॉम मास सेल. सो मास सेल्स आर रिलीजिंग ल्यूकोट्रींस. एंड ल्यूकोट्रींस वॉट डू दे डू? दे कॉज टाइटनिंग ऑफ एयरवे मसल्स एंड प्रोडक्शन ऑफ एक्सेस म्यूकस एंड फ्लूइड. सो ल्यूकोट्रींस आर प्रोडक्ट्स ऑफ एरिकिडोनिक एसिड मेटाबॉलिज्म. दे आर रिलीज फ्रॉम मास सेल एंड व्हेन ल्यूकोट्रींस आर रिलीज दे कॉज टाइटनिंग ऑफ एयरवे मसल्स एंड प्रोडक्शन ऑफ एक्सेस म्यूकस एंड फ्लूइड्स. ओके, so that was all about different definitions. Okay, now we are going to study pathophysiology in two slides. So whenever you have exposure or re-exposure to sensitized allergens, okay, re-exposure means once you get sensitized and once you eat that same thing, it is called as a re-exposure. Okay, so it can be exposure for the first time or it can be a re-exposure to the sensitized allergen. So whenever this occurs, the allergen may cross-link the mast cell or basophil. Now what do you mean by this cross-link? Cross-linking is formation of covalent bonding, okay, covalent bonds or short sequences of शॉर्ट सीक्वेंसेस ऑफ केमिकल बॉन्ड्स. क्रॉस लिंकिंग किसको बोलते हैं? लिंकिंग ऑफ शॉर्ट सीक्वेंसेस ऑफ केमिकल सब्सटेंसेस. ओके, सो एलर्जेंस में क्रॉस लिंक द मास सेल और बेसोफिल. मीन्स वॉट एवर इज द एलर्जन वी शुड बी स्टडिंग वॉट आर द allergens. So if you remember the case scenario, that was peanut, so that is allergen here. See, okay, so whatever is allergen may will cross link with mast cell and the basophil. So there is a bonding between allergen and the mast cell or the basophil. Okay, now this leads to cellular degranulation. We have studied that what is degranulation. It is a release of mediators. Okay, there is cellular degranulation as well as de novo synthesis of mediator. Okay, so cellular degranulation, we have studied that already prepared mediators are released, so that is called as cellular degranulation. And apart from that new mediators which is formed from simple substances such as sugar and amino acids, so they are formed. Then this leads to the mast cell will cause the release of IgE. We have already studied IgE because whenever mast cell is activated, mast cell gives a signal for production of IgE from B lymphocytes. So when IgE is produced, so IgE binds to the antigen which provokes the allergic reaction. Okay, so antigen which is causing allergic reaction, the IgE will bind to it. Okay, IgE then activates the FcRn receptors on mast cell and basophils. Okay, see, we have two steps here. First is IgE binding to the antigen. Okay, and how does IgE come into force? Because mast cell, they signal. So whenever in allergic reaction, when mast cell is activated by this allergen attaching to the mast cell will cause the release of IgE. So what will IgE do? IgE will bind to the antigen. IgE will bind to the antigen, which causes the allergic reaction. Okay, then once it binds, so what does it do? IgE then activates FcE1R1 receptors on mast cell and basophil. And what are FcE1R1 receptors? We have already studied. So FcE1R1 receptors are IgE receptors. They are IgE receptors which are present in mast cells and basophils. Okay, so IgE then activates. So they activate the FcE1R1 receptors. So they are IgE receptors. So these receptors are present on the mast cells and the basophils. Now this causes release of inflammatory mediators such as histamine. We know, we have studied in the earlier slides, basophils, they also contain histamine, mast cells, they also contain histamine. So when IgE receptors, which are called as FEC1 receptors, these are IgE receptors which are present in the mast cells and basophils. So when that gets activated, it causes release of inflammatory mediators such as histamine. Now what will histamine do? Histamine will bind to H1 receptors. Okay, these are histamine receptors. Histamine H1, we have two receptors, H1 and H2. So in an allergic reaction or anaphylactic shock, histamine will bind to H1 receptors. So when it binds to H1 receptors, so these are the symptoms: pruritus. Pruritus means itching, yeah, khujli. Okay, rhinorrhea, then tachycardia and bronchospasm. Okay, pruritus, that is itching, rhinorrhea, that is running nose, and tachycardia, increased heart rate, and bronchospasm. Okay, which will lead to the spasm of the respiratory system will lead to respiratory difficulties. Okay, so we have listened to the case scenario that she was having a respiratory short. She was having shortness of breath. So this was due to bronchospasm. Okay, so H1, so when histamine is attaching to H1 receptors, so these are the symptoms. Okay, apart from that, prostaglandin D2, this is released from mast cell. So they mediate bronchospasm and vascular dilation. Okay, so mast cell, they also release prostaglandin D2. So when prostaglandin D2 are released, they mediate bronchospasm and vascular dilation, and these are main symptoms of anaphylactic reaction. Okay, now apart from that, leukotriene, we have earlier studied about leukotriene. Leukotrienes are products of arachidonic acid metabolism and are released from mast cell, which causes tightening of airway muscle and production of excess mucus and fluids. Okay, so here with leukotriene, C4 is released from the mast cell, and C4 is converted to LTD4 and LTE, LTD4 and LTE4. This is C4. Okay, LTC4 is converted to LTD4 and LTE4. So they are mediators of hypotension, bronchospasm, and mucus secretion. Okay, so leukotriene C4 is converted to LTD4 and LTE4, and they causes hypotension, bronchospasm, mucus secretion, and these all causes tightness of the chest, and there is increased mucus secretion. Okay, so this was all about pathophysiology of anaphylactic shock. I will repeat it once again. So whenever a person is exposed or re-exposed to a sensitized allergen, re-exposed means pehli bar peanut khaya, some mild symptoms were there. Second time when the person eats, there is a severe reaction. So that is called as re-exposure. Same thing, फिर से आप expose हो गए. So that is called as re-exposure. So exposure or re-exposure to the sensitized allergen. Allergen may cross-link the mast cell or basophil. And what is the meaning of cross-link? Cross-link means formation of covalent bonds or short sequences of chemical bonds. So that is called as cross-link. So allergen will cross-link with mast cell and basophil. So this leads to cellular degranulation as well as de novo synthesis of mediators. So whenever there is the allergen is attaching to mast cell, so here is there is cellular degranulation. We have studied the meaning of cellular degranulation. Degranulation means there is a release of mediators. Okay, so it can be stored mediators or it can be de novo synthesis. What is de novo synthesis? Formation of complex substances from simple substances like sugar and amino acids. Okay, so this is allergen when they are cross linking with mast cells or basophil. So this will lead to cellular degranulation, or some new things also may be formed. Now IgE, how is IgE coming to the picture? Because mast cell, we have already studied, mast cell signals the formation of IgE whenever allergic reactions are there, and IgE is formed from B lymphocytes. Okay, and it is mast cell which stimulates it. So IgE binds to the antigen which provokes the allergic reaction. Okay, now what will IgE do? IgE will bind to the antigen. Okay, so when it is binding to the antigen, it activates the FcER1 receptors. And where are these receptors? These are IgE receptors. So FcER1 receptors are present on the mast cells and the basophils. Okay, so once IgE is released, so IgE will activate the FcER1 receptors which are present on mast cells and basophils. So when they are activated, this causes release of histamine. We have already studied that histamine is produced from mast cell as well as basophils. Okay, so they causes release of histamine. And what will histamine do? Histamine will attach to this H1 receptors. So H1 receptors, when it is attaching or binding, so this causes pruritus, rhinorrhea, tachycardia, and bronchospasm. Prostaglandin D2 is also released by the mast cell. So what they do is they mediate bronchospasm and vascular dilatation, which are basic symptoms of anaphylactic. Mast cell also causes release of leukotriene. So here leukotriene C4, that is LTC4, is converted to LTD4 and LTE4, and these are mediators of hypotension, bronchospasm, and increased mucus secretion. So that was all about the pathophysiology of anaphylactic shock. Okay, so these is just a diagrammatic representation of the what are the symptoms which the histamine is causing. Histamine causes upper respiratory symptoms like rhinorrhea, sneezing, angioedema, and stridor. It also causes respiratory problems like cough, wheeze, dyspnea, bronchoconstriction, and hypoxia. Also causes digestive symptoms like nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and diarrhea. Causes cardiovascular problems like hypotension, tachycardia, vasodilatation, increased vascular permeability, and syncope. And it also stimulates the skin, which causes flushing, urticaria, angioedema, and itching. So these are caused by hypotension. These are caused by histamines. Okay. Now, what are the statistics and incidences? It occurs worldwide in different ages. Worldwide, it is 0.05 to 2% of the population. They experience anaphylactics at some point of life. 1 in 50 Americans they experience. It usually occurs in young people and female. Mortality is 0.3%. 13% of anaphylactics, these are findings of different studies, and 13% of out of the anaphylaxis which is occur, 13% of anaphylaxis occur in hospital because drugs also cause it. Or clinic, 6.4% they occur in a friend's house or relative's house, 6.1% occur in workplace, 6.1% restaurant, and 2.6% in schools. Okay, so these are the various incidences. Now these are the allergens. Okay, we have used this word allergens. Allergens are those agents which causes allergies. So that is why they are called as allergens. Okay, so allergens are of different types. First is food. It can be eggs, seafood, tree nuts, grains, milk, and peanuts. Peanut was one of that in the case scenario. Drugs, especially penicillin or a cephalosporin, a sulfa antibiotic, maybe ibuprofen or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Insect stings. So these are the different insects. Bees, yellow jackets are those insects which has blackish color wings with yellow spots. Okay, so they are yellow jackets, paper wasps, hornets, and fire ants. So these are all different types of insects which causes anaphylactic shock. Then injected anesthetics, procaine and lidocaine can occur. Dyes which are used for diagnostic x-rays and scans can cause allergic reaction. Industrial chemicals, latex and rubber products which are used by healthcare products also can cause allergic reaction. Clinical manifestation, the first symptom is anxiety. The first symptoms usually include a feeling of impending doom or fright. We have seen the case scenario. If somebody has it suddenly, so this causes a great anxiety. The person feels as if is going to, something bad is going to happen, and the person becomes very frightened. Skin reaction, hives, I will be showing the picture, itching, flushed or pale skin also follow. Shortness of breath because of the constriction of airways. We have studied what are the leukotrienes causes a tightening of chest, and there is a swollen tongue, throat because of bronchospasm which cause wheezing and troubled breathing. Okay, these are skin hives. So these are the symptoms of skin hives. Angioedema of the face. Then these are hives, another types of hives. There is swelling of conjunctiva. Can you see this? Okay, this is angioedema of the face. Apart from that, hypotension, we have seen what are the in the pathophysiology. Hypotension is also caused by different pathophysiological changes. Okay, so hypotension, so that is why we have seen in the case scenario that the person was feeling dizzy. Okay, then tachycardia. Because the heart tries to, whenever there is shock, we have seen the compensatory mechanism, and tachycardia is also one of those. And dizziness, the patient feels as if is going to fall down, and which leads to fainting. Now different assessment tests are there. First is histamine and tryptase assessment. Histamine, we know, histamine has to be tested in the blood, and this will help us to understand whether there are chances of recurrent anaphylactic reaction. Okay, so and tryptase assessment is a useful indicator for mast cell activation. We have studied in pathophysiology, mast cell plays a very important role in allergic reaction. So whether this is present or not, we have to do a test of tryptase. So if a patient is seen shortly after an episode, plasma histamine and urinary histamine metabolites or serum tryptase measurements. So these are used. This is a useful indication for mast cell activation. Okay. Second is 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid levels. 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid levels. So this level has to be tested. Why? Because we have a syndrome. This is a cancerous rare type of cancer which is called as carcinoid syndrome, and in carcinoid syndrome one of the symptoms is flushed face. One of the symptoms is flushed face. So we have seen in symptom flushing of the face is there. So if we are anticipating carcinoid symptoms, then 24 hours 5-hydroxy indole acetic acid levels should be considered to so this is for differential diagnosis. But is it a carcinoid syndrome or is it or is this flushing due to the anaphylactic reaction? Then different food, we have studied lot many foods are causing diagnostic reaction. So can cause anaphylactic shock. So we there's a testing for food allergy. See if the patient's medical history and physical examination suggest a possible association with food, food ingestion means taking inside. So percutaneous, we just put it under the skin, that is we puncture the skin and have a percutaneous food allergen specific skin test or in vitro specific IgE test. For example, radio allergo adsorbent assay test. This is called as RAST, radio allergo sorbent assay test. So RAST is test is done, or immunocap IgE tests are performed with an understanding that these tests can have both false positive and false negative. So these tests are available, but they can give us a false positive or they can give a false negative. So they are not 100% proof test. Okay, so this is how we have multiple, we inject it on the skin and then we check it, skin allergy testing. Then is testing for medication allergy. All of you must have worked in clinical area where the doctor must have ordered penicillin injection. So whenever penicillin injections are ordered, it is mandatory to do a skin testing for this before you give the actual dose. Why? Because we are trying to find out whether the patient is allergic to penicillin or not. So penicillin, if the patient is sensitive to penicillin, it can lead to severe anaphylactic reaction and we may even lose the life of the child of the patient. Okay, so medication allergy is very important. So skin testing for penicillin has to be performed. Then testing for suspected insect bite is also there, whether we have in this previous one we have tested for food. This is testing for food allergy. Then this was this is how we do for skin allergy test. Okay, then this was for medication allergy, especially for penicillin, do a skin test and then we give the if no allergic reactions are there, then we give the full dose. Then insects also cause anaphylactic shock. So we are interested to know whether they are causing or the person is sensitive to it. So if a patient history suggests inject skin, so we have a allergen specific skin test to hymenoptera venoms. So hymenoptera venoms are insect venoms. ठीक है? We have studied different insect bite can also cause anaphylactic shock. So is the person allergic to insect bites? For that, hymenoptera venoms, allergic specific skin testing to hymenoptera venoms are performed. Now, what is a first aid? Loosen the tight clothing and cover the patient with a blanket. Do not give anything to drink because of the bronchospasm. Then, if there is vomiting or bleeding from the mouth, turn the person to his side to prevent choking. And if there is no signs of breathing, then we begin CPR. Now, in medical management, we remove the antigen. Okay, if we know the antigen, it has to be removed. Suppose if it is a medication, then we have to stop it as early as possible. Okay, next is we remove the antigen. If it is an insect which is biting, we have to remove this. If it is a bees, then we remove the person from the bees. If the person is taking food which is causing, then we have to stop that intake. So that is remove the antigen, such as discontinuing it can be one antibiotic agent. Okay, then we have studied that penicillin some non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs can also cause antigen anaphylactic shock. So whatever is the antigen, we have to remove that. It may be drugs. then we have to administer medications that restore the vascular tone and provide emergency support for basic life functions. So here you have a patient who is hypotensive, who is having tightness of breath, the person is dizzy, the BP falls down, so this is, and the patient is in respiratory distress. So we need to give medications. What are those medications which are going to study in subsequent slide? And we have to give CPR. If cardiac arrest and respiratory arrest is imminent or has occurred, then we give cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Endotracheal intubation is also required to provide an airway. Then IV therapy, IV lines has to be inserted so that the medications can be given proper time. So these are the medications: epinephrine, which is called as adrenaline, beta agonists such as albuterol, then as IV antihistamines and cortisone and oxygen. Okay, these are the medicines. Now, what are the action? Adrenaline is a strong vasoconstrictor action through alpha adrenergic stimulation. This activity counteracts the vasodilatation and increased vascular permeability, leading to loss of intravascular fluid and subsequent hypotension, which are important pharmacological features in anaphylactic shock. We have studied in anaphylactic there is vasodilatation, there is increased vascular permeability, and because of that there is hypotension. So adrenaline is a strong vasoconstrictor. BP se badhega. Okay, this it has a strong vasoconstrictor action. Albuterol, it is a beta agonist for bronchospasm. So isko dene se hum log salbutamol, albuterol is salbutamol. Okay, so it relaxes the bronchial smooth muscle action by action on beta 2 receptors. Okay, so there is tightening of chest due to bronchospasm by leukotrienes, so albuterol will relax that bronchial smooth muscle. Then is diphenhydramine injection, Benadryl. It also comes in oral forms, also comes in injectable form, so that is given. This is an antihistamine, so histamine ke against mein aapko dena padega, so we give injection Benadryl. Or if the person has mild symptoms, then we give promethazine also. We also give promethazine. Promethazine is Phenargan. Okay, so this diphenhydramine injection is used to treat life-threatening allergic reaction that is anaphylactic, along with epinephrine and other treatment. Okay, next is hydrocortisone. Hydrocortisone such as sodium succinate should be administered after severe anaphylactic reaction to avert late sequelae, late complications. To avoid that, we have to give hydrocortisone injections. Okay, so this was then we will continue with this. Epinephrine is given for his vasoconstrictors. Adrenaline, epinephrine, these are all same thing. Okay, so this is given for his vasoconstrictor reaction. For emergency situation, it comes in epinephrine comes in 1 ml ampules with a ratio of 1:1,000. Okay, aqueous solution we gave 0.1 to 0.5 ml, and these are released repeated every 5 to 20 minutes depending on the severity of the condition. Then is diphenhydramine Benadryl is administered to reverse the effect of histamine, thereby reducing capillary permeability. To decrease the effect of histamine, we give diphenhydramine. Albuterol is may be given to reverse histamine induced bronchospasm. Okay, so that is why we give salbutamol. Then nursing assessment, assess any kind of allergy. The nurse must assess all patients for allergies or previous reactions to antigen. So whenever you have a patient who is coming with an anaphylactic shock, so it is very important to take a history. We have studied what are the allergens, history to drugs, history to foods, all these things we have already studied. So all these things has to be assessed. Then assess the patient's knowledge. The nurse must also assess the patient's understanding of the previous reaction and steps which are taken to patient and the family to prevent further exposure to reaction. Suppose bee sting and insects are there, so what steps the patients are take to, taking to avoid insect bites. Then new allergies. So when new allergies are identified, the nurses advises the patient to wear or carry identification of the names, the specific allergen or antigen. So whatever, whenever you take a history, if the patient is allergic to drugs, allergic to some foods, allergy to maybe some dyes, or allergy to some insects, so the patient should carry a identification card which mentions the history of the allergic reactions. Okay, so what is the nursing diagnosis? Impaired gas exchange related to ventilation perfusion imbalance, altered tissue perfusion related to decreased blood flow secondary to vascular disorder due to anaphylactic reaction, ineffective breathing pattern related to swelling of the nasal mucosal wall, then acute pain related to gastric irritation, then impaired skin integrity related to changes in circulation. Now, nursing care planning and goals. The client will maintain an effective breathing pattern as evidenced by relaxed breathing at normal rate and depth, and an absence of adventitious blood sounds. We have already studied about adventitious blood sound in the earlier video. Adventitious blood sounds are rails, wheezing, etc. Okay, stridor. These are all adventitious abnormal breath sounds. Then client will demonstrate improved ventilation as evidenced by absence of shortness of breath and respiratory distress, and the client will display hemodynamic stability as evidenced with strong peripheral pulses, heart rate 60 to 100 beats per minute with regular rhythm, systolic BP within 20 mm of Hg of baseline, and urine output greater than 30 ml per hour, warm dye screen, and alert responsive mentation. Okay, so this these are the healthcare planning and goals. More is there. Client and significant others will verbalize understanding of the allergic reaction, its prevention and management. We need to train the family members also related to understanding of this and its prevention and management. And client and significant others will verbalize the understanding of the need to carry emergency components for intervention, need to inform healthcare providers of allergy, need to wear medical alert necklace, and the importance of seeking emergency care. Okay, so client and significant others will verbalize that they should keep emergency equipments with them. Equipments, we are talking about some basic drugs, and keeping also a list of medication or list of things with which, against which the person is having an allergy. Okay, the nursing interventionist monitor client airway. So that is very important because of the sensation of a narrowed airway. Monitor the oxygenation status. And for that, we need to monitor oxygen saturation, and we also do ABG analysis. Then focus breathing, instruct the client to breathe slowly and deeply. Activity is encouraged, educate, rest, and limit activities within client's tolerance. Okay. Now positioning, position the client upright, as this position provides oxygenation by promoting maximum chest expansion and this position of choice during respiratory distress. Okay, so again, this will depend on the condition of the patient. If the patient can be managed in upright position, that is the best one. Why? Because we know that in upright position, diaphragm comes down and the lungs get more space to expand and fill with air. So upright position. So suppose if CPR is going on, then this cannot be given in upright position. But we when CPR is not given, so position during that, it is better to give a upright position. So this can, suppose if the patient is in hospital, we can raise the head of the patient. Then hemodynamic parameters, monitor the client's CVP, pulmonary artery diastolic pressure, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and cardiac output and cardiac index. Okay, so if you have the facility, we can monitor all these things. Then monitor the renal output. So urine output, the renal system compensates for low pressure by retaining water. Oliguria is a classic sign of inadequate renal perfusion. If the kidneys are affected, so it will manifest as oliguria. Okay. Next is what is evaluation? The client maintained an effective breathing pattern. Client demonstrated improved ventilation. Client displayed hemodynamic stability. Client and significant others verbalized understanding of allergic reaction, its prevention and management. So this was this is the evaluation, and client and significant others verbalized the understanding of the need to carry emergency components for intervention, need to inform healthcare providers for allergy, need to wear medic alert bracelet or necklace, and importance of seeking emergency care. Okay, so the patients should understand why they should carry the list of allergens what they have, and why should they should inform the healthcare providers for allergy, and they need to wear medical bracelet or necklace, and it is very important to seek emergency care, because bronchospasm or hypotension is there. This is this progress is very fast, so that is why it is important to seek emergency care. Now, discharge and home-based home care guidelines. Emergency medication. The nurse should provide information about emergency medications. We have studied what are those and plans that should be considered should a crisis reoccur. Suppose if it is occurring again, what steps has to be taken. Precipitating factors. Must assist the client or family in identifying factors which precipitate or exacerbate crisis. We have studied a list of allergens. So if the patient is sensitive, the nurse should reinforce that and educate the patient so that the patients can be away from those allergens. Now, prevention. Avoid exposure to allergen. Whatever be the allergen, may be drug, may be food or insect bite, may be dyes. So all these things has to be the exposure has to be avoided. Desensitization. If a patient must receive a drug to which is allergic, prevent a severe reaction by making sure it receives a careful desensitization, which with gradually increases doses of antigen or advanced administration of steroids. So desensitization may be done by giving steroids, okay, or maybe by gradually increasing the dose of antigen. So then it the person will not be desensitized. Then monitoring. Closely monitor the patient undergoing diagnostic tests and use radiographic contrast media, okay, such as excretory, urography, cardiac catheterization, and angiography. For that also the skin test is done to find out whether the patient is allergic to dyes. Okay, so whenever the person is undergoing such diagnostic test, we have to be very vigilant whether the patient is tolerating or whether the patient is having severe anaphylactic reaction. Okay, the best way to prevent anaphylaxis is to avoid the substance that causes. Wear a medical alert necklace which indicates what are the issues, and keep an emergency kit with prescribed medication available, and your doctor can advise you on the contents. If you have a epinephrine auto injector, so we have a epinephrine, we have studied, it has to be given immediately. So we start with 0.5 ml, and it can be repeated every 5 to 20 ml depending on the severity. Okay, so there are epinephrine auto injectors are there. Then check the expiration date and be sure to refill the prescription before it expires. Okay, so if you have epinephrine auto injector, so we have to check whether some expiry date is checked or not. Then be sure to alert all the doctors related to your medication allergy. And if you are allergic to stinging insects, use caution according to you. So for that, what can you do? Wear long sleeve shirts and pants. Do not walk barefoot on grass. Avoid bright colors because this will attract insects. Do not wear perfumes. Again, this will attract insects. Colognes or scented lotions. Do not drink from open soda can outdoors. Stay calm when near a sting insect. Move away slowly and avoid slapping the insect. So if by doing so, it may even bite you. If you have food allergy, carefully read the labels of the food which you buy so that you can identify whether those food items are there or not. Okay. Then while eating out, how each dish is prepared, and try to find out what are the ingredients. If you are allergic to peanuts, so whenever you order anything, please check whether you whatever you are ordering, does it contain peanut or not. Even small amounts of food you are allergic can cause severe reaction. So that has to be kept in mind. Okay. Then is what are the complications? Basically, two complications: respiratory obstruction and systemic vascular collapse. The trachea may close up due to severe inflammation, which could result in respiratory obstruction. Can you see this? So this is the rate of bronchospasm. Okay. Then systemic vascular collapse: sudden loss of blood flow to the brain and other organ can cause systemic vascular collapse. The prognosis: the death from anaphylaxis from these causes is usually associated with delayed treatment. If you give treatment early, the patient's life can be saved. If unrecognized and treated promptly with epinephrine, the prognosis is generally good, and vast majority of the patients, they recover fully. Okay. Case fatality rates were 0.25% to 0.33% among hospitalized patients, and in emergency department it was 0.33%. Okay, and these rates represent between 63 and 99 deaths per year in US. So that was all about anaphylactic reaction. I hope you have understood this topic. Thank you for your patient listening.